It's another edition of Time About the Movies, and today we're taking a look at the films of February 28th, 1997. We've got six movies to look at. One, two, three, four. Yeah, six movies. So we have a lot of movies to get to, so let's just go ahead and jump on into it. We'll start off with the biggest new release of the weekend, and that is Johnny Depp and Al Pacino in Donnie Brasco.
When I introduce you, I'm going to say, this is a friend of mine. That means you're connected, guy. Now, if I said instead, this is a friend of ours, that would mean you're a maid guy. A capiche?
When Lefty brought Donnie into his world...
Who's this guy? This is Donnie, a friend of mine.
He took a risk on a kid he hardly knew.
I'm enough to school you, my friend.
School me in what?
This guy never carries his money in a wallet, see? Always in a roll. Bina, on the outside.
He gave him his trust.
You gotta get rid of that mustache. Get yourself a pair of pants. Just like me.
He loved him like a son.
Nobody can touch you because I represent you. Keep your nose clean, follow the rules, be a good army, and maybe one day when they open the books, you could come a wise guy. I'd die with you, darling.
So this is based on the true story of Joseph Pistone. He actually wrote a book called Donnie Brasco, My Undercover Life in the Mafia, which was published in 1988, and not too long after Barry Levinson had garnered an Academy Award for directing Rain Man, he actually bought the film rights and actually served as a consultant on the book. And within a couple of years, he was actually going to direct the film, but then he got Stephen Frears to direct the film initially, and it was going to come out in 1990, but because Goodfellas had come out that year, and it followed kind of a... and that became the premier mob film of the time period. I was about to say it followed the same story, but not really. But the plans for the film got pushed back, so Stephen Frears that year actually directed The Grifters, which we've talked about before. And he was also very adamant about casting Pacino as Lefty, Lefty Ruggiero. And this film spent a number of years in development hell. Frears eventually moved on. They got Mike Newell to come in and direct this, and Pacino and Depp ended up being cast in the starring roles, and Joseph Pistone actually served as a consultant to help them develop the characters in the film, and you can definitely see the effort being put in there. The film itself is a really damn good film. It's a solid piece of entertainment, largely benefited by the performances of Pacino and Johnny Depp. They play these roles very well here. You can see a little bit of hints of what The Departed would eventually become 10 years later. And a little bit of course, Internal Affairs, which, of course, was the film that The Departed was remade off of. And you can see a lot of things about the movie that worked. The casting overall was great. Michael Madsen, Bruno Kirby, Anne Hesh, Zelko Jovanic, Zach Grenier, Tim Blake Nelson, Paul Giamatti, Gretchen Mol. A really good cast overall here. And the film itself is a very compelling and very enjoyable film all around. It's a film that has a lot of great visuals. The 1970s look incredible in here. It's an overall really good film, largely beneficial on the performances, the direction by Mike Newell. Not much more I can add to this one. It's a pretty enjoyable film. If you haven't seen it, definitely check it out, especially if you want to see some of Johnny Depp's best acting in this, as well as Pacino's. They, like I said, they're both very good in this film. Probably some of their strongest performances they've done, so... that's pretty much all I got for you on that one. That's Donnie Brasco. So let's go ahead and take a look at our next movie, and that is Booty Call.
Let me see your eyes now. Nope, I don't think so. Duck feet, big nose, pop eyes, steam hairline. Too thin you can't win. Too thin you can't win.
Hey, look, man, you ain't got to take that job back, baby. Job back.
Damn it, when I need helical sales, I will call helical sales.
See, that's why I don't like relationships, man. That's why I strictly deal with booty calls. 3Ms, no questions asked.
Rashawn and Buns.
I'm here to serve you tonight.
Well, I got three things for you. Backup, Yoko Ono.
They have one thing on their mind.
So Rashawn's friend is cute, right?
Oh, he's cute enough. Listerine, this is fun.
Did you see that tarantula hair, fool?
But to get the women they want...
You know I do not mess with anyone that does not have class.
And you know, you looking, you know, you looking pretty good.
They'll try impressing them.
Well, looky here.
What is that?
It's a gold gas card.
And I got platinum privileges, too, because, you know, if you buy enough gas, they give you coffee mugs and stuff.
They'll try romancing them.
Oh, girl, your feet are kind of strong, but the softest feet in the world.
Hell, man, get them big jungle rat alligator feet off mine, man.
And if that doesn't work...
Don't you think we need some protection?
These women are running us. We're not running them.
Hey, you want some dinner, Dan? I got your dinner thing.
They'll try anything.
Ladder up at 2 in the morning? So like you're planning to eat more than a sandwich, bro.
Would you look at here? Perhaps they're waiting to...
Columbia Pictures presents...
You got to lick it before you kick it!
Jamie Foxx.
Dr. Moore needs some help in obstetrics. She's having a baby.
Oh, well, it ain't mine.
Tommy Davidson.
This girl's got a lot of class, all right? So act like you got a mama. Like you wouldn't mix up in some test tube.
Vivica Fox.
No glove, no love.
I got a glove right here.
And Tamala Jones.
Who knows? You and Bonds just might hit it off.
Chow guy.
Booty call.
I'm very attracted to you. These beautiful eyes, those cheekbones, that smile, and I love the little mustache. It's working.
So yeah, judging by that trailer, that movie did not look like it was going to sell itself very well. But just from that trailer alone, I mean, That looked pretty bad. I mean, some of that comedy in there was just not that funny. Some of it worked, but most of it looked like those one of those comedy trailers from kind of like today's modern comedy trailers where they think they have something really funny to show you, and there's just nothing there. If I had seen that trailer first back when this movie came out, I probably would never want to see this movie. But I saw that trailer long after I saw that movie. And the movie itself is just, it's all right. Like, really, I went into it expecting a lot more because I saw it got some good reviews. Most notably, Siskel and Ebert gave it 2 thumbs up. And usually when they do that, it's usually something I'll kind of enjoy. They compare it to humor to something like Beavis and Butthead, which I guess you could say that, but not really, honestly. There's only a couple moments in there where it kind of feels like that, but even Beavis and Butthead would know to be a little bit smarter than that, but... As far as the movie itself goes, it's not a bad movie. It is a fun film. You do like the chemistry between Jamie Foxx and Tommy Davidson, as well as the relationship, the chemistry they have with Vivica A. Fox and Tamala Jones. But most of the time, the comedy in here isn't all that great. Sometimes you'll get a good laugh here and there, but it's not really it's not really all over the place. It's very few and far between. And coincidentally, this was a film that actually was written around the same time of another movie with a similar premise to it. A film called Trojan War, which featured an all-white cast. Jennifer Love Hewitt, Will Friedle from Boy Meets World, and Marley Shelton in it. And it was directed by George Huang, who did Swimming with Sharks. And the funny thing is, they had no idea that that movie was even being made when they wrote this movie. And you know, you chalk that up to something similar to like what Dante's Peak and Volcano was. I don't think anybody really knew that both of those films were coming together at the same time, or maybe they did. I don't know, but. I thought that was pretty interesting. Also, the original script was actually heavily rewritten by the director, Jeff Pollock, as well as Tommy Davidson. And, as far as the movie itself goes, I mean, it was fine for what it was. I also found it pretty interesting that Charles Dutton actually criticized young African-Americans who went to see the film rather than the historical drama Rosewood, which, in a way, he kind of has a point to it. But at the same time, I mean... You're asking young African Americans to choose between a historical drama by John Singleton or a sex comedy with Tommy Davidson and Jamie Foxx in it. I mean, most kids. Plus, they probably figure most of those kids will probably see that movie in school one day when they have to talk about the events there. So, in a way, I definitely see where he's coming from. But at the same time, I think he was kind of a little bit. Bottom line, he's entitled to his own opinion, and honestly, I can't really blame him for it, because Rosewood is the far superior movie, but I could see why the young kids would go see Booty Call over Rosewood, honestly, but as I said before, as far as the movie itself goes, it's fine for what it is. There are some funny moments in there. I like the acting from the four leads. There's just not a whole lot there that really makes it a must-see movie. I saw it, was expecting a lot more from it, but I was kind of a little let down by it, honestly. But at the same time, I didn't really hate it. I just thought it was all right for what it was. So, that's just my personal take on it. So that's Booty Call. So let's go ahead and move on to the next movie, and that is Smilla Sense of Snow.
Solve this mystery. One woman must use all her senses.
He was murdered.
The critics call Smilla smart and spellbinding, a poetic and lyrical thriller. Julia Ormond, Gabriel Byrne. Smilla Sense of Snow, rated R, now playing.
So this is based off of a novel called Miss Miller's Feeling for Snow, which was actually the title of the UK release of the film. You've got a story about this transplanted Greenlander, Smilla Jasperson, played by Julia Ormond, who investigates the mysterious death of the small Inuit boy who lives in this housing complex in Copenhagen. She suspects wrongdoing. She uncovers a trail of clues leading towards a secretive corporation that has made several mysterious expeditions to Greenland. That's really all I know about this one. I've never seen this film before. Good cast overall here. Julia Ormond, Gabriel Byrne, Richard Harris, Robert Loggia, Vanessa Redgrave. But like I said before, nothing really I know about this movie. What the hell was even that? There's not a whole much. What I meant to say is there's not a whole lot there I can really say about this movie is what I was trying to say. I don't know what the heck was that. But there's not a whole much there I know about this because I've never seen this film. I don't really know if it's any good or not. I've talked about how I usually like these type of movies that takes place in the winter and the snowfall and all that, so I don't know, maybe there might be something there I might kind of enjoy, but other than that, though, it's just, that's pretty much all I got to say about that one, since I haven't seen it, so, in fact, most of these other movies here I haven't really seen, so we can be real quick on these ones here, so, on to the next one, and that is Hard Eight.
$50, what would you do?
I'd eat.
How long can you eat, how long can you live on $50?
I don't know.
I would bet not very long.
This film is actually based off of a short film called Cigarettes and Coffee, which I thought at first was kind of also the inspiration for Coffee and Cigarettes, the movie that eventually came out about 7 years later, but that turns out to be, that's all just Jim Jarmusch's own series of films. I don't know if they're really connected or anything like that, but I thought that was pretty interesting. But basically, you follow the story of this senior gambler played by Philip Baker Hall, and John C. Reilly is this homeless man. You see Gwyneth Paltrow in here as well as Samuel Jackson. It's the directorial debut for Paul Thomas Anderson, who'd later go on to make much better films. He'd go on to make much better films in Boogie Nights and Magnolia, Punch Drunk Love, There Will Be Blood, Inherent Vice, The Master of Licorice Pizza. I don't really know for sure if this is a good film or not. I've never really even heard about it until now. So, I mean, it could be pretty good. I mean, Paul Thomas Anderson does make a lot of really good movies, so I wouldn't put it past him to make something pretty good out of this. So, again, that's really all I know about this one. So, on to the next movie, and that is Kama Sutra, A Tale of Love. Another movie I've never seen, so I don't really know too much about it. It's directed by Mira Nair. We've talked about a couple of her movies on this show, including The Perez Family and the really good Mississippi Masala with Denzel Washington. This one has Naveen Andrews, and Indira Varma, who was also on Game of Thrones. Naveen Andrews, of course, is from Lost. But this is based off of a portion of the film is based off of Utran, Hand-Me-Downs, which is a short story in Urdu by the Indian writer Wajida Tabassum, and I think I'm pronouncing that right. If I'm not, I'm sorry. But like I said, I really don't know anything about this film. I've never seen it before. But the reviews for it are kind of mixed. They're not as good as some of Mira Nair's other works. I'm assuming this one's not as good as some of her other films. So I'm just going to take it from that because, like I said, I haven't seen the film, so I don't really know if it's that good or not. And I'm judging by the reviews I see for it, probably is not that good. So all I know about that one. So let's move on to the last film, which is Follow Me Home.
It's people like you who put a stain on the moral fabric of this once great land.
I can taste the salt of my tears as I swallow the truth.
Never seen this one before, but it does have an interesting history behind it. You follow spiritual and intercultural race relationships through the lives of four artists, one African-American, one Native American, and two Latin American cousins, one of them played by Benjamin Bratt, I believe, who embark on this cross-country road trip to paint a mural at the White House, and along the way they meet this mysterious African-American woman played by Alfie Woodard. Good Lord, I almost said Viola Davis. But this woman's played by Alfie Woodard, who bears a deep secret, and The interesting thing about this, it's never been picked up by a major distribution company. It's been shown on request at universities and community centers. And then they have a Native American activist named Lakota Hardin actually come in and do a discussion afterward. But the film did apparently get a re-release in 2020, right around the time of the George Floyd protest, the Black Lives Matter protest. And you even see that trailer is from said re-release. So a very interesting situation there. So I don't really know too much about this movie as a whole. But knowing that, I mean, this movie has some kind of a legacy to it that maybe I'm not aware. But then again, I've never seen this movie, so I don't really know if it's any good or not. But kind of an interesting story to go off of that. So, that's pretty much all I got for you on that one. Follow me home. So with that said, that wraps up another edition of Time About the Movies. When we meet next time, we'll jump into March with seven movies, I believe. Yeah, seven movies. Howard Stern's Private Parts. We have Tim Allen's Jungle to Jungle. Rhyme and Reason. Boys Luck 2. Good Luck. The Day Trippers. And The Eighth Day. So seven movies overall to look at. We'll take a look at them on the next episode. But until then, thank you very much for watching. And if you want to see more videos like this, please hit the playlist on the next page. Check out the previous episode. And I will see you guys tomorrow for another episode. So thank you very much for watching. I'll see you next time. And until then, as always, take care.